The interview design is often referred to as an interview study. These words are often interchanged, as is common in some of the vocabulary and what you might read or hear people talk about. The basic interview research is that in this design, that's it. There's only interviews. There's nothing else to look at. There's really no type of triangulation that's needed of different sources of data. The only thing there is the results of the interviews held about whatever the topic is. This is one reason why some do not believe the interview research design is substantial or significant to produce findings that's worthy of a doctoral dissertation. That's not to say it can't be done. I've had a couple mentees in my 20 years who have applied the interview research design, but they had a specific reason and they were able to justify its application. Most students who I hear early on in their ideas who say, well, you know, maybe I want to do an interview design. I'll ask them, of course, to explain why, what they think the value will be. Then I'll ask to compare it to what the value might be from doing just a little more work and having a case study or a phenomenological design applied. Oftentimes, the student just doesn't understand early enough. I've also had this concern with many people from corporate research departments, such as corporate organizations who want to do research, and they think, well, the best thing to do is just go interview people. Well, it's not always going to produce the best outcome. Oftentimes, the reality is having somebody like me or a dissertation chair, somebody with a certain amount of years of expertise, understand better all the different options available and can suggest perhaps other ways to produce more valid information for better decision making. In the interview design, this may be one of the few opportunities, and this is certainly an advantage of an interview design, where it can be beneficial to the interviewee, for those you interview, because in the interview design, you can actually engage in a conversation. It's almost encouraged that you do more than just ask a question, but you engage in that conversation. And oftentimes it's that engagement, that conversation, that allows the interviewee to think about something never thought about before and give a different answer. And they will say, I never thought about that way before, so now I've learned something new. That is one of the benefits of doing interview design. As I mentioned earlier and throughout this program, the reason we have so many different qualitative designs is because we want to use that right tool for the purpose at hand. In this case, the tool would be the interview design. We still, like in many other aspects of qualitative research, seek to identify commonalities of those we've interviewed. No matter what the questions, even if some people had different questions, the end goal is to produce at the end some commonalities. What were the themes? What were the common understandings of everybody that was interviewed? We would look to find still what was common. We'd also want to know maybe what was different, if a few people had something different to say than everybody else. Oftentimes it's what's different is what's the power in doing such a research. While ideally we look for commonalities, we also want to look at outliers and find out why outliers are there and do they have any real meaning. One such example is to look at how strategies have been applied. And the idea is that through an interview design, we can ask people about their actual lived experiences in that process. Here are a couple examples, like a coping process that somebody had gone through during perhaps a struggle in their lives. Maybe mentally they were coping with a death of a family member, maybe the reality of COVID-19 and all its ramifications in our society. Might be something as simple as a business startup, where we want to ask about what their process were. What did they do? What did they think? What did they perceive? We want to gain a rich understanding about as many different experiences related to the research topic itself. We are going to look to uncover the meanings of the participants' experiences. But in this interview design, we have more options to do that. And I'll share a few of those as we go through this lesson strategy. But we want to look at the meanings of the participants, their experiences, and maybe some of them were real experiences or perceived experiences. That's okay. We're going to ask about those and make distinctions through our interviewing process. The interview questions do not need to align to a specific protocol, as does, for example, a case study or phenomenology. In a case study, we're usually asking how and why questions about what happened in a certain situation. In phenomenology, we're only asking questions about lived experiences, which often is defined by identifying one's assumptions, beliefs, or perceptions about what they they went through. But in interview design, we can mix. We can ask almost anything, whereas in the other designs, we cannot do that. And again, this is one of the benefits of an interview design. It opens the door for a more robust interview and therefore, hopefully, more robust findings. Now, that may be a challenge for everybody when they're trying to analyze the data, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's bad. It just may mean it takes more creativity to come out with the understandings or the meanings of the research. As in most other qualitative research designs and just about everything dealing with research, I suggest you do not ask about one's feelings about what their experiences were, unless you're a psychologist or you're in a psychology program and you have psychologists who can help you. They're experts in understanding and analyzing feelings. Most people without a psychology background just do not have the skills to do that. There's a certain level of skill that needs to be done to truly reflect feelings of people. I certainly am not certified to train that, and so therefore I definitely don't train people on it or ask them to include such questions, and I'll be pretty adamant about telling students not to include such questions. And most of the time in non-psychology based programs, the students may be using the word feelings inaccurately when we really want to know, you know, about what did somebody think or believe about the process they've been through. Oftentimes speaking with poor speaking habits and using the wrong words often allows for confusion in research. And so we want to eliminate that confusion, eliminate any potential variation so that what we get in the data is accurate for the purpose of our study. Binary questions are more acceptable with follow-up explanations and examples being sought in an interview design. In most qualitative research designs where it involves viewing people, such as, again, a case study or phenomenology, we do not ask binary questions that produce a yes or no answer. We would reword the phrase so everybody had a certain experience and they would tell us about it in their answers. But here we can have the binary questions, but if you do have a binary question, you ask somebody if they participated in something, they said yes, then you want them to explain what they thought about that process or whatever it is you're looking to learn. Because the outcome of a binary response would be nothing more than perhaps 6 out of 10 said something, 60% said something. That really doesn't give us a rich narrative to create much meaning from. But if we said that 6 out of 10 said yes, and these are the common factors of those, that would be great. We may even indicate that 4 out of 10 did not, and this is what was common with them. So we can start to see that here in an interview design, the flexibility to be able to ask different types of questions to get different varieties of findings can be very powerful. Here is an opportunity that allows the researcher to identify one's own commonalities to those interviewed and get a deeper insight into what is being studied. Here, a researcher may ask questions, but also interject their own experiences. They may say, based on my experiences, and then ask the question, or they may engage with the person that's being interviewed and share their own experiences. And so therefore, a researcher now, here in this design, gets to apply more of themselves instead of just being an interviewer asking questions and then being quiet and listening for the responses and just kind of managing a conversation. Here, with an interview design, the researcher can actually get involved in a discussion. Now, the problem is with a discussion that goes on too long, there could be too much data at the end when you have to analyze it. So if there's going to be that conversation and you're going to do this interview design, I encourage you to have less actual interview questions and any discussion still stay focused. As an interviewer, yes, you can get involved, but you also need to be cognizant that you don't want to take any stories where it goes too far off the topic just because of its interest to you personally.